They were predicting snow and we got no snow. But we got plenty of birds this morning. So as soon as breakfast is over, it's time to move on to the next step. And I'm glad we're done with that cockpit area, at least for now. Do you think they care about my cockpit? I think they care about my Spitfire. Forget it. Look at the coloring on the face of this guy. He's got white around his eyes. And he never comes up to the feeder. So we always put a little bit of seed on the ground for him. You can come up to the feeder. They're not gonna bite you, those white eyes.
Now this morning, the first thing I want to start laying out, this O-drive and the exhaust, because I need to do this as a unit. I need to lay out these pieces of wood, get a pattern, carve it up roughly, get the spacing to the spinner, spacing around the front, and then lay out the pipes. And let me just show you how complicated this can be. I would do a little storyboard here, because I've thought this through. I've had plenty of time to think it through. Now here's the dilemma. We have the spinner, what I think is as correct as it can be. We have the canopy area as close to correct. And we have the wing placement that we have no choice on. And this is the logic of trying to figure this out. On a real full-size Spitfire, we'd be dealing with this area. But if we made these full-size, if we made them scale-size, what's going to happen? They're going to be way out of proportion. I think they're going to be way too big. So what's going to happen, like all artwork, that requires a little interpolation. And I don't know how much interpolation until I carve up a piece. So the objective would be, first off, to carve the piece oversized. Now it has to match in a lot of ways. I don't want this to be, in other words, let me show what I'm talking about. When you look at these from the side view, let's call them blisters. The blisters show from the side view and from the top view. And if we get it wrong, if we put these up on top of the fuselage, it's going to look like, incorrect anyway, not going to look scale. If we get them too low, it's going to look incorrect. If we make them too long, it's going to look incorrect. If we make them too short, it's going to look terrible.
Now just as an example, on a Seafire, the compromises, see how short they have to be? Because we had a 10 inch nose. And if I made these much bigger, it would look way out of proportion. So this is where the compromises start to come in. Just as an example, the early Spits have a very small blister, and some of them in this case, just like our I-beam ship, have the Siamese exhausts. And there are several varieties of different exhausts, but I want to try to combine the best of all the worlds here, and I want to try to make these so that they look as realistic as possible to a late model Spit. Now the one thing we know is they can't be dead scale. So if I resign myself to the fact, and I had thought of a good way to do this, or a way that I'd be happy with anyway, what I wanted to do is I wanted to make them very oversized to begin with. And since they won't be hollow, I can constantly make them smaller and smaller and smaller until I feel like I have the proper proportion. But it also doesn't take into account, and this comes down like so, that I have to lay out where the exhaust pipes are going to reside. Now the exhaust pipes reside in a proportion to this. So I just can't have this go back here. That's going to look fake. And I can't have this stretch way out here. So what it probably means is I'm going to need a bigger diameter exhaust pipe at some point in time to keep the proportion and the aspect ratio close. Now the first thing to keep in mind is the pipes on the late model Spits go straight back. Now that's one advantage, because what that eliminates for us, we only have to make one mold. If they angle down, we'd pretty much have to make two molds.
So this simplifies it somewhat, but we still have to carve those blisters. Now Joe sent this picture last time he was here, but look at the ratio here. The pipes go almost to the root of the wing, so I can see how far back. That's almost more than 3/4 of the length of the nose moment arm, so that would mean the pipes have to be a pretty big diameter. And the ogive on some of these really late model ones comes way around. Now there are several variations of this. This one comes way around. Some of the ones like the Blue Spitz, well, this one has the counter rotator, and I think part of this is to contain the gearbox, or they move the engine forward or something, because these are different than the ones in most of the late model Spitz books. This doesn't come around as much, and it just has a little bit of a kerf over the front there. So that gives us even more choices when we're going to lay this out of how we want this to look. Because again, we're not modeling any particular Spit. This is basically just a Griffin-powered Spitfire.
That is one little side benefit to these exhaust manifolds. If we do them up for the model that we're anticipating with the straight back sweep, they'll be appropriate to a lot of other models in the same scale. The problem is they're probably going to wind up being too big for a nobler size model, maybe even too big for our original Spitz. So what I'm trying to do is lay out the pipes and lay out the ogive both at the same time. And if you look real close on this, you can see how different this ogive is. Very different than this one. That comes almost to a point up under the spinners. And of course, this is a Seafire. This is not a Seafire, it's a Spitfire. But I'm looking and I'm trying to be real careful not to paint myself into a corner here, because it would be very nice if I can replicate these in a scale with this, that they go very close to being scale. And of course they're not going to be totally scale, but how close I can get them. And I say that over and over again because this is something I've thought about for a long time. I've got 9 inches of nose moment, and I'm probably going to be able to make the valve cover blisters at least 8, and make the exhaust pipes at least, well, we're going to start laying it out in scale on the model and just see what we can come up with. This is something obviously what's going to happen too is this woodwork and the scoop underneath the wing, those two pieces of woodwork finish the woodwork on the model, and then we'll be getting from that point on, it'll be mostly finishing, detailing, airbrushing, picking out a paint job. I can't wait. Now, I may put the motor and cowling on this at some point in time, but right now I just need to rough this in. And what I need to get is that proportion right. And I'm sure this is something, the one thing I know for sure, I'm going to do this over and over until I get it right, because this is a critical thing. So the first thing is I want to make up a pattern of what size I think this would be, but the pattern will be oversized. Now, I'm only using these because these are ones that we've made in various sizes for various projects. Some are larger. These are all reject parts that I took out of the drawer just to see what should be. These have the rake already in them. See, now the problem is, here's one of the problems. We're trying to fill a 9-inch spot. This is not going to fill a 9-inch spot at that level. However, I have these pipes. What I need to do is get a bunch of these and lay them out, and I've got the mold already made for these. And some little tiny ones that we made for a 35 ship. Now, the point is, I know none of these are within the proportional scale that I need right now. So that was the first thing I needed to figure out or come to grips with here. In fact, I have a couple of these, a couple extra ones. These are all rejects. But I can just lay these out just to get an idea what the length would be. Now I've got one of the old ones that needs a lot of work, a lot of cleanup. Actually, what I could do, one of the choices, and I don't need to make this decision right now, I could clean this up and use it for a plug
to make a new mold. See, the mold, here's what happened years ago. I was using Art Supply rubber. And this is really cheese ball-y stuff. This is not the real professional stuff. We hadn't discovered smooth on yet. And what happens, you make two or three parts, and this is really like not really good quality stuff. But what it would allow me to do, and I guess I could do it here, I could patch this up or whatever. This would be one possibility, and this is almost, this is as close as we're going to get to be in the right shape, I can see right now. So I'm going to put this on a back burner for now, since the first thing I need to do is get the ogives working and get some patterns made for that piece of balsa wood. Again, maybe one of the things you can pick up off the DVD is that sequence of things of how to lay out, again, Spitfire, very complex shapes, almost all curves, and proportions, aspect ratios, and shapes to get them just right, or to where you think they're right. So what I'll try to do is just rough out, that's not even going to be rough, what I think the proportion of this should be. Needless to say, it's going to be way bigger than it has to be. Just rough some of these out. I can make patterns all day long until I'm happy with the size and the shape. Now, before I even go any further, I tried to make one that I thought was on the small side. And this kind of looks pretty much like what the Spitfire looks like. Now, if I just get it right in that joint. And then I said, well, let's make one a little bit bigger. And let's see if that does anything for me. And it looks like, see, when I put the spinner on, it looks like the bigger of the two might be more appropriate. So what I'm going to do is, and of course I know this is going to be too big, and I know this is going to be on the small side, so I'm probably going to wind up with this trimmed down, and then when I'm done, make a final pattern. So now the next thing is to get up a rough piece of wood and cut one of these out and see what it looks like in real life. So I found a good piece of scrap that I can use just to make, and because we know this is going to be an oversized piece. Again, all this looks real easy when it's all done, and you look at a model, it's all put together and buffed out, and you think, ah, that's nothing. When you start to make these individual pieces, especially a little piece like this, we might have to make 10 of these. We might work on this for a week. I don't know, but I sure don't want to just compromise it. Now, of course, we're oversized in every dimension. In fact, I left a little extra here because I wasn't sure of how this curve. On some views, it sweeps up. Some, it's pretty symmetrical. Now, this is the spare test shell we made with some real heavy-duty wood. And this is a good time to put it to use. Take a piece of our Bernie Trent sticky-back sandpaper and just laminate it on. This is going to serve us with getting this curve in here. Or at least get us close on the curve. Okay, now the one problem we have is this has a curve. If we were mounting it up there, we'd have a perfect fit. But on a curve, of course, like all Spitfire things, it gets more complicated. See, it's rocking. So in essence, we're going to have a curve. Within this curve, there's going to be a curve this way before we get this part finished. But just to look at it in full scale, I can see that, well, I think it's too big. Before I even go any further, I'm going to trim it down around the whole perimeter about an eighth of an inch. But had I made it too small, I can't make another part. So it's a lot easier to do it this way. At least for me it is. Now it's just a question of picking a number. Excuse me. Again, we're going to be going back and forth. If you remember when I laid out the Seafire rudder, if you go back that far, or if you're that old, what you remember is that it just doesn't jump out of the can. And at least on a piece like this, if you make even a rudder too big, it's easier to trim it down a little bit, especially patterns. Once you make something too small, you got to go back to square one. So now that I have the curve in it, what I want to cut this on a jigsaw so the curve part is up. And I just want to take this amount off. And then see if I'm in better proportion. Now if you look, and this is complicated to me anyway, what's happened is we've taken about 3/32 of an inch off. But notice what's happened here. We've taken 3/32 of an inch off here and 3/32 off the length. So the aspect ratio has changed. And now this part is starting to look longer than it should. So now I'm going to take a little bit and I'm just going to take a wild guess of how much I have to take off the back. Because again, if I take this an equal amount off here and here, and this part is 10 times wider, I've made this part in essence look a lot longer. And that's the whole trick of semi-scale, is to do this without making it look wrong. Now you can start to see how we're evolving this shape, and this is going to be the next adjustment because I want to get, and I'm going to take some of the length off. Because it's just when you look at the part we're trying to replicate, it's starting to look too long. And I can picture six exhaust pipes here, it's going to end about here. This part's going to wind up being too long. Now it's slow, it's coming slow, but little by little, it's starting to look like what I think it should look like, or what I hope this is going to look like at the end of a couple of sessions. Now we're sneaking up on it, and as I get closer and closer, what I want to do, of course, is make a pattern, because obviously I have to do the other side. Now this isn't a final pattern, but I can tell, and this is one thing I like about videotape and everything, if I were to forget what the pattern this is, I'll try to make each one, mark this number 3. I got 1 and 2 here. This is just for my reference, because maybe when I finish this up, I'll be thinking, uh-oh, that doesn't look right, I have to do it over, and then that'll be number 4. But having a pattern, and now we have a rough block, I can get some idea of what this is going to look like. Okay, now, by looking up at this, I don't have the scale length. But on the other hand, I think this is pretty close. And I don't really, I'm going to assume it's going to line up. See, I don't want to have it crooked like that. It's going to be right on that line. Now I'm just looking at this and I'm thinking of something. See, this is what, as this evolves, let me get another thing. So you got to constantly do this mock-up thing. We're going to be right even with that as step one. Once that's carved, this is going to get, in fact, I got to adjust this radius a little bit. Yeah. So, just assuming I'll just have a dummy exhaust and that's going to change. Now, I think the next part of this is going to be, realistically, is just to carve this up. Now, I suspect that what's going to happen is when I'm done carving this, it may look a little too small. I'm just guessing that, but I want to get that curve in there. Then I want to start roughing it out. I've got an accurate pattern now. So if I'm happy with this, I can replicate it. If not, I'll expand it. What I think, it's just going to look too thin this way. But again, until I see it with the curve in there, I'm not really going to know. And it's only going to take an hour or so to carve this up. So may as well. Remember the old skyhook? Do you remember that? If you were sure. Everybody in the world is 60 years old. They remember the skyhook. That's what it looks like. And I also tried. I have these on Miss Ashley, and I have a mold for them, but they're way too small. Because Miss Ashley has that narrow fuselage, so we're not going to save anything by trying to use up an old mold.
That is really no simple way to do this other than to just carve up a few pieces, and maybe this is one of them. And I have the picture I'm constantly looking at, and then I can just reach up here and take a look at how it's going to fit. But there's certainly a lot of wood has to get carved away here, so there's no point in... Ultimately, I believe we'll figure out how thick this part, maybe if it's a half inch, I can just saw a half inch of it off to begin with. But until I carve one, I'm not really going to know. And this actually is just a piece of scrap. I don't... just not sure what size this is going to be ultimately. And I'm looking, and that curve starts right about where the exhausts end. Obviously, a good choice would be, as we always do, a brand new blade. And I love to throw blades away because I know I'm not wasting my time then trying to carve, especially when it's not good wood, when it's 8-pound wood or whatever we have here. It remains constant for the part. Let's just go look at this. Still way too wide, I can see that. That's for sure too wide. Actually, I probably could start with, if I had a... I could take a quarter inch off of the block. It would just save me some carving. You know, if I want to save all the carbon in the world, I can just stop building models. It really saves a lot of carbon. Now, I really do enjoy. This is one of the parts I enjoy. Let's see, we're going to get down to about, I don't want to get too skinny here. We can do some of this in real time. That's going to be a blend. Now, it's still too thick in the primary part here. Right here, it's too thick. Boy, there's a lot of give and take when you're cutting something like this up. And then the idea is when you have to make the mirror image of it, it gets even trickier. But we'll tough it out, I'm sure. I was just thinking of something funny. You know, Karen and I have talked about taking art lessons together, and what I thought would be funny is when the instructor says, well, Mr. Artnowski, what would you like to paint for your first picture? A flower or an apple sitting on a table or something? I said, Spitfire, of course.
Spitfire? What's a Spitfire?
Can you hear him now? Anyway, but Karen really is enjoying that, and I'm so happy that she's enjoying that. And we will be, the unveiling will be this week. Her first picture. Okay, we're almost coming up on having a rough cut on this. Still too white up here. What's going to happen if it's too white up here? We're going to have to make the exhaust manifold a foot long. And we'll probably wind up making a new mold. Now let's see how close we are. Of course, we've done that in real time. I'm sure everybody will be impressed. Now, it still rocks because I don't have it straight. Well, I'm going to go over to the sanding bench and sand it and see how it looks. And we're pretty close, believe it or not. Now, I'm doing a little more carving because I don't like to do any sanding. I don't have to in the house. And I can't really go outside with the way it is out there. Realistically, unless I'm an Eskimo. I'm trying to do most of the carving just to minimize the dust. Needless to say, because of Karen's allergies and breathing issues and asthma and everything, we have to always try to minimize the dust. And I'm really, really trying to do most of it. Now, obviously, if you, just as an example of something that sometimes slips by a lot of people, if you didn't have that extra shell, you could just use the fuselage itself to sand in a canopy or to sand in a part like this. There's no reason you can't just put the sticky back paper, even on a plane that has a finish on it. Use it for a buck. Anyway, we get most of this done. Just do the final little bit on a sanding table. And I think we're coming up on it. I'm not sure. As I'm looking at that part, what happens is as I look at this part, and I try to mimic it for the aspect ratio, and as it gets to the end of the pipes, it dives up just a little bit more than mine does. Maybe I'll have to repattern this, but it does dive up. Oh yeah, changes everything. And sometimes it's just one little angle. It's amazing, especially on a rudder shape. One little angle, one little thing, one little radius, and the whole thing is wrong. And you want to go bite the X-Acto knife. Ice shavings. Now, as I hold it there, I think I've got it pretty close. I'm all excited, but maybe I don't. Until I see it in real life, I'll know. And by looking even at several of them, it's really it's pretty close, I guess. In fact, the only thing I see that I don't like here is I have the front too short. So if I remake this and make another pattern, I need to leave more material in the front here. See that? Maybe a deal breaker, maybe not. But once I carve this up, I'll have what I hope is going to be a good pattern anyway. But even if I have to make an extra one, it's not a big deal, of course. These go quickly, a couple hours, and I'll have another one. But I'll have that look, and I'll have the thickness, and I'll know exactly what I want to do and not do on the next one. I know that sweep up there is going to be a part of it. And I know this thickness down by the manifold has to be correct. That's why it's so important to have books, pictures, We've used those Rich Wallbridge pictures that he sent over the last year or so. Wow, did we use those to our advantage. And anytime I need to, I can just go put that DVD in, go up to the chapter, it's always in a separate chapter, and play them over and over again. Very nice. And of course, we thank Rich for all of them. And everybody that sent stuff in. And it's no different if, and I'm just an example, Gerald Champ's P-47 is no different than this. It's just different parts, but you're still trying to get the proportion, the aspect ratio, and the look. And then, of course, the ultimate thing is then when it's all done that it doesn't weigh a ton, that you haven't built a guy that's too heavy. Now, I'm just looking at this, and the more I look at it, I think I am going to have to remake this. But I'm close. And it's just going to be this part up here that has to be, and in fact, I can figure out from the book, I can figure the aspect ratio is basically the width of the part back. So that makes it, and see, I don't have that. I'm short by maybe a quarter of an inch. But at least I know now what this is going to look like in real scale, and I know the overall proportion of it I have. Now, I can't really tell, but I'm sure this has to go back. From looking at this, this is going to be way too short. But I can tell what the thickness is going to be, again, from the little bit of carving, is the thickness here and the thickness in the front are going to be pretty equal. In fact, it's longer. It's the thickness plus maybe an eighth of a thickness. So I can interpolate that out. And I'm just going to start now. Now I have a spare piece, make up a new pattern. It's like punting the football. I don't know about that punting the football thing. Anyway, and we'll start on making another part. But I've got a lot of this right already, and I think in the next one, I'll get it really right. So now we try to take all the things we know we're satisfied with. We've got this much of it right, up to here. And around here, and I think that is exactly what I want. Now, what I do want to do is I want to extend this piece so that this piece comes down. And again, this is a lot of interpolation. Now I've got, if you can see the difference, that is a lot more like what the real one. Even though we're on an angle here, I can measure the aspect ratio. It's way more than 1:1. Yes! Yeah, Kent Tyser's on the phone. Now, as this part has evolved, and I've gone through these parts, I realize, again, that this part up here was the deal breaker. But as I came up with pattern number 5, pretty much everything is the same. I've made it a little bit, maybe a 16th of an inch bigger, because I've added this. I didn't want it to all of a sudden get too skinny as I add length to it. So I've added length. It's going to set the exhaust back just a little bit, and it's about a 64th bigger. So now the trick is, and we go through this whole exercise again, but rather than be frustrated, what I'm keying in on is that each one of these, I'm happier and happier that we've come up to what amounts to be to look at that prototype part, and you can kind of just hold it that way. And it's this part up here that I think was the only thing that was wrong with this last copy. And now this would be fun. Obviously I can't do two of them yet, because I want to be sure that I got this right. And I'm not sure about this little hook in here even. That's the other deal breaker here. That little hook might be an issue, because I want that to be more prototypical.
And this sweep up here, I think we have it right. And each time you do this, it gets a little bit better. And I don't think it's really possible even to get this on the first shot. It just takes time. So step one is we're going to cut out the part. Now I think this might be what I hope will be the final shape. But it took 5 tries as far as making patterns go. And I think one of the things you can pick up off of the, is just how I go about doing this, and certainly doesn't mean this is the ultimate way, but it's one way to improvise, one way to create a semi-scale plane. And if you're better at drafting and drawing and you can draw all this, but the problem with plans, and Al Raby said it best, is you can't see it in 3 dimensions. And you look at a plane with a tail and a wing and this and that, or in this case the O-drive, it may look great on a drawing. And you see it in full scale and it looks big or small. When you can work in 3 dimensions like this, I just think it's easier. It's longer in the beginning, but somewhere down the road you make up for it. Now, that looks like I've got the curve in there. Now I could start the carving.
Now the thing I don't know is about this hook, if this is going to have less of an angle. And on the real ship, you really can't see if that's a straight line, but I'm going to leave it here because I can always remove it a lot easier than adding it. Now, again, having this part and having the look and being able to just look at it just makes the carving. Now, oh, this is a lot better piece of wood than the first one was. I can feel it already. But the difference between carving an 8-pound block and a 6-pound, this may be 6. This was a decent block, not a piece of scrap. And can you imagine years ago, and these are the things just makes me crazy about the modern world. I remember as a kid going to the hobby shop and seeing stacks of 4-pound wood, 6-pound wood, the lightest wood. Buy a Vico kit, it was loaded up with 4-pound wood. There was 4-pound wood everywhere. It was just unbelievable. And boy, now, yeah, you gotta buy a lot of wood to get a couple of sheets of 4-pound wood. Or else you gotta grow your own trees or something. I don't know what the deal is. But anyway, I think we're sneaking up on this, and I think it's only a matter of, it's not even going to be a matter of time. I'm excited that we're going to have this very soon. Now, the trick is, once I get one of these that I'm happy with, then I got to make the mirror image. And that's a little more difficult than it may seem in the beginning. Now, I could have, and I didn't even think of it, I could have cut 1/4 inch of this off and just saved myself some carving. And the trick with any carving, I think, is always hold the knife at a 45-degree angle, always use a new blade. The quality of a carving when you have a dull blade goes down dramatically, at least for me it does, because you're forcing it. It's not gliding through there. And I always have that original part to look at to see if I'm getting too skinny, too thin. And I like to always look at that curve. And the reason I'm leaving a camera running and it's in real time is because a lot of people, an awful lot of people, it's one of the most common questions. If I'm talking to somebody and I say, what did you get off of the video? I say, wow, I watched how you carved a cowl or a plug or a top block. And that's something that, well, show me somebody that wrote about it recently. Yeah, not really. Difficult. But a part like this, to get it right on the first shot, I don't usually get it right. And maybe part of that is that I'm just too fussy. But maybe not. Maybe I'm just... getting this bullnose front is a critical thing too. Once I get the thickness, let's see. And I'm always looking at it from several different angles. And that bullnose part, that's the difficult part. And that's that distinctive bullnose look that right behind a spinner, it just juts out. Now, if you have a family or a household where dust is, or you can go outside, dust is not a problem. Richard Oliver could just go out in his backyard and sand all year long. Or even with my dust bench, I always prefer, if I can, to go outside. But this time of year, not happening. Okay, that's close. I'm close. Now it comes down to those last few ice shavings. And then the mirror imaging is always challenging. And this thickness here, now I can see this thickness here is too thick. Right there, it's too thick. That's the problem. Or I remember carving wheel pants years ago. You'd carve the left pant. You try to make the right pant match it, it'd be an inch longer or a quarter inch fatter. And I'd make six before I was happy with them. Now we only have to make five. We've moved up in a food chain. Yeah, that's getting close. Okay, closer and closer. But see, once you have the first part, then you can at least eyeball it. In this case, I don't know if this is too thick until I hold it up. I can look from the top. Yeah, it's getting there. And I think we got that thickness about right. A little bit thinner. Just a little thinner. Amazing how too, when you're on a part like this, if you're off a 16th of an inch, it looks awful. You really do lose the whole effect. The rest I can sand down. Now a big part of this is flat because it's a cover for a valve cover, so that the whole center part is totally flat, and we don't want to have this be like the like a watermelon shape. And this is a straight line. And this is a straight line. We don't want to trade that away. That sanded out pretty nice. Now let's see how it looks. That's the main thing. Now here's the dilemma here when you put this into real time. The front, I want to make sure. I'm talking about a lot of material too. See what's going to happen if I just make a banana out of this. The valve covers are going to cant in. So I really just have to take material out of here. What needs to happen is I need to take material out of the back, not the front, which is going to bring this up. I or now this is just an interpolation. That's why I'm glad I made this a little big. Because this curve, I don't want to have this, that these are bowed in. I want to have it that they're parallel, because the valve covers would be parallel. So what it means is I just have to take some of that material off the back now. Now the way to get this, and it's an easy thing to do, is to hollow the part out. And I'll explain why in a minute. When you hollow it out, then the only part you have to start removing material from is instead of a whole piece, and in fact, this should get thicker as it goes out here. Now, let's see if this is going to work the way I want it to. Because if I can get it to just rest on the edge, it'll be a lot easier to adjust the edge than to adjust this whole flat surface. Now, I really don't have to hollow it to where it's paper thin right now, but I need to get some of this material out so that it's only resting on the edge. That'll make lining it up a little bit easier, I think. And we've got to go about an eighth of an inch here. I've got to pull an eighth of an inch of material off of this. Or I've got to figure out some way to shim the front up. Put a spacer or block or something there. Again, it's tricky. If it was easy, everybody'd have a Spitfire in their Air Force. Or you can just do the Merlin Spits that don't have this. Let me get the rest of this out, and then we'll see if we can adjust that angular edge. The polywogs with the reverse curve are nice for hollowing this out and getting a last little bit of material out of there, of course. And I can hold this up to the light and see if I've got any thin spots, and then I want to start carving down that edge and see if I'm going to be able to use this or if I'm going to have to account for that by making another part. Now, the problem is I've got to start taking material off of this back. And let's just see if, just for instance, I don't know how much we're going to be able to take off of there realistically. Yeah, that looks like about it, in fact. And get out our fake fuselage side here, and we know we have to put a bend in this. Okay, we've got a little bit of it in there. Let's see what we get. Now I'm thinking I can take some of this out by, let's see, if I can just remove from the bottom, so I'm glad I made this piece oversized, if I can take some of that out, again, I don't know if this is going to work, this is yet to be proven. what I'm doing, I'm putting a slight curve in there, but not a terrible curve. Oh, I hate this dust. Oh yeah, a lot better. So I can repeat that over and over again until I get this curve, and I want to line up the bottom line with the joint, or just over the joint, maybe an eighth of an inch. Cover that joint up. Might be to our advantage. Now what I did, I moved the sandpaper over because I'm working from both ends toward the middle now. And this is just to get the final little bit on there, and I think I've got it pretty close right now. And it's easier for me to work off the end of the sandpaper here. Now the question is to get the final fit, and I'm sure the final fit we're going to be finagling with for quite a while.
Now the next step on this is going to be spacing, and what's nice about having this datum line is I can space it using that datum line as for parallel, because here's the thing, if you put them on that way, I'm sure in flight you'd see it, and I want to have it as accurate as possible. Now, I think if you put them on, I'm just using an example, way too high, you'd notice it right away. And if you put them way too low, it's going to look wrong because the valve covers, this is a V engine. And I have to figure out the spacing from the front, which I'm not sure of yet. Boy, I have to be very honest and say, boy, I'm happy the way that worked out. So now, here's the next step. The next step is going to be to get out a block, and we're not going to do it today. We're at the end of this session today, but get out a block, replicate this shape, make an accurate pattern, and the next time we get to work on this, we're going to carve the mirror image of it. But you know what's nice is, and it's just, I was talking to several people this afternoon, and one of them is my good friend Donnie Haber, who always likes to come over and run trains in the afternoon, and this is a good time. I've not run the trains in a couple of weeks, and Arnie always adds a little excitement to the afternoon. Now I just thought I'd look at these valve covers while I was waiting for Arnie to get here. These seem to work out pretty prototypically, except yet the thing you have to keep in mind is look at the width of the fuselage. And I've got to kind of account for that in the equation. And the fact that this is a 10-inch nose, not a 9-inch nose, so. But it's still good to have some reference. And of course the first Spitfire is a Merlin one, so it doesn't have any real ogive up there at all. But just something to think about. And hey, when it's time to run the trains, it's time to run the trains. And boy, we've been working real hard on our Spitfire project, and it's always good to take a break. Always good to see the friends we don't see all the time, too. And I've been trying real hard to get Arnie, who's a former control line flyer. He used to build scale models. Get back into control line, and all he wants to do is work on his train layout.
Thank you. Now, it's been a long time since we've seen Jamie Kajewski. And Mike has gotten a new Harley, of course, and he's supposed to come over sometime. So I can put the Harley on DVD for him so he can send it to his daughter, who's in Oklahoma. So, Jamie, we miss you. She used to fly pretty well. She was with us at the field all the time. She had, and Mike actually had her working on planes and stuff and helping him mow the grass. So, the kind of daughter you hate to lose. But hey, when you want to buy a Harley, you got to pay. Anyway, we expect Mike here sometime, but I'm not sure when. Down here, and I hear Mike Kajewski upstairs. I just heard a motorcycle pull in a parking lot, and I know he just bought a new Harley, so I think my session's going to be postponed while we go for a motorcycle ride or something here.
Look at this. He's got his own helmet. Oh, look at this.
Look at this.
Put it on. Let me see what you look like.
Wait a minute.
Put the glasses and everything.
Yeah, the whole deal's
you
right.
Go for the whole chopper package here.
Wait. We got to put this. This is the wintertime scarf.
Oh, man.
James,
you got long johns on? Let's see.
No,
you sissy. You're a tough guy.
Okay, this is the scarf we wear.
That scarf's going to blow up in your eye at going 80 miles an hour.
No. Then we put this on.
You don't even know how to tie it. Look at that.
Oh, look at this guy.
And then we zip this up.
Oh, look at this.
I love you, Jane. just like skiing, Jane.
Let's see, did they put carbon fiber on this? Is this carbon fiber helmet?
Nice stuff.
Nice
oh, boy, you got your money's worth out of this. What is this, like 50 bucks?
Yeah.
Carbon fiber Kajewski.
Okay.
Oh, my, yeah, look at this. You know, if I worked for the INS, I'd already have you in the back of the car and handcuffed.
This is great.
Now look, here's the definition of good looking, here's good looking, ugly. Good looking, ugly. Oh man. Jamie?
You want to go out and see it?
Come on.
Sure.
Where do you see
put a jacket on.
Where do you see the color?
Come on, where you got in the driveway?
I'll grab something from the back.
Oh, take her for a ride.
No.
You're not that good yet, huh?
No. I'm lucky I can.
Notice she takes me for a ride, yeah.
Okay.
She wants to get her license, you know.
Let's go.
The birds will poop right on it. Hey, that's a nice color.
Nice.
All right. Now, we got to make you a cardinal to match. See, that would be the whole deal here.
I used to have a cardinal that color, if you remember.
I remember. Hey, this looks nice.
Beautiful.
Now, is this a little more reliable than the old green one?
Absolutely.
Just a bit, huh?
Oh, look at all the crown.
Nice. Yeah, that looks nice, Mike. Boy, good luck with this guy.
Yep.
Helmet to match.
Mm. This is the second helmet. The first helmet is the winter helmet. This is going to be the summer helmet.
Yeah, so of course, there's snow on the ground. He wears the summer helmet, so he looks cool,
winter
right?
The winter helmet comes all the way over. It's got the big chin guard. It's got
okay.
The face.
Oh, yeah, on. Yeah, for the winter.
For the winter.
This is nice. They did a nice job with that. Nice bike.
It's too cold for me.
Okay.
Nice bike.
When are you going for this thing?
I don't know. I have an appointment Friday to see the doctor, then probably the next week. I'll let you know.
Okay. All right. Listen, don't worry. I'm telling you, don't worry. Good. I'm glad.
96 cubic inches. So what do you want to tell Jamie?
Well?
You want your last will and testament? Dear Jamie.
Jamie, when I die, this is it. It's yours.
No, it isn't. I'm going to go get it right away. Now, you got a place to keep this, or are you going to put it in my garage?
Yeah.
You got a place? Okay. Could they steal these bitches right away, boy?
Oh, they steal this faster than they steal potato chips.
Oh, this will go faster. You leave this out in a bar, go and have a drink,
forget
you come
it.
Out, your helmet's sitting there.
Bye-bye. And you know what? I heard that these guys at these big motorcycle things.
Yeah.
You could have it locked up.
Doesn't matter.
They
doesn't
come
matter.
In a van.
It's not model aviation.
Yeah, they come
they
in
take
a van.
The lock and all.
No, they come with a van.
Sure.
And six of these big gorillas get out. And pick it up
and
throw it in a van. It's gone.
I was with the kids in Greenwich Village one night, and a guy had a Triumph, a smaller bike than this. And this is belt drive, too. That's nice.
Yeah.
And he had it locked and chained and all kind of stuff. They came, and the truck pulled up. It never even, I don't think it was idle in 30 seconds. They picked it up, threw it in the truck, and took off.
Yeah.
Now, if you were where my car is, you wouldn't have got...
No.
And maybe they leave one guy behind in case you show up, they smack you in the head with a brick or something.
Smack you in the head with a brick.
That's how many miles you got on it? Where's the, you need, it's electronic.
Here we go, we can
that's
get it
nice. On. How many miles? 119, holy shit, it's probably out of warranty already if it's a Harley.
Look at this, look, we can push the buttons. Look,
What happens when you push the button?
What does this say? 1180? What does that mean? I forget.
I don't know. Is that the mileage? How many miles?
246.
Oh. Oh, God almighty. This is not what I think motorcycling should be about. Oh, man. Motorcycling's supposed to be a man's sport. You go. Hey, you going to get a Harley, too? Here comes the cops. Look, they know he's coming. Look. Hey, they stole my Harley. They stole my Harley. Look at this. You believe this? Come on over. Let's check it out. Man, that is nice. You know, if my wife would let me have a Ducati, I could ride with it. See, you could have some influence on her. She's inside. Tell her Wendy needs a Ducati to be happy. Wendy needs a Ducati. Oh, would I like to go down to the Ducati dealer tonight and go $72,900.
All right.
$72,000 for a Ducati. That's nice, Mike.
Okay.
This is the reason this plane never gets built. Here's the reason right here.
I'm the guy.
Too many Harleys and too little valve covers.
Wow,
holy
mackerel. Look how nice you're coming along.
You're impressed,
here.
Huh?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, I can tell you. I'll tell you, with friends like you, I'd never get this plane built. I may as well just forget about it.
I think you're just
unbelievable.
Lollygagging around here.
Now what I did, I only got a little bit of time left at the end of the day here, and I thought one of the things I could do that'll get me a little bit ahead is, I took out all these spare little parts that we have, and these are all the little parts we made several of these molds, and I'd mix up just some spare resin. Some of these molds are shot like that one. And just fill everything with molding epoxy, so that what I'm going to try to do then is then when I get the fresh parts out of here, pick the ones that look the closest to scale, or the best, or whatever. And then I'll be able to have some more inventory. Actually, even if I use one of these to make another mold, but when I get a part that I'm really satisfied with, and I'll just fill these up tonight off camera, what I'm gonna do is, and we had so much company today, and trains, and Mike, and our neighbor next door, they went to look at a house. But what's gonna happen is then, when I come back in the morning, these will have usable parts in them, I hope. And we'll have some more stuff to lay out, because again, this I have to figure out which one of these I'm going to use. And while those parts are drying, or the mold is drying, it'll be real easy for me to just carve up the mirror image part on that. So this is just like a little bit of time management here tonight. So I got all four of the latest molds filled to make some fresh plugs. And when I could pull these out in the morning, or the next session, should get some idea of which size and which shape we're going to want to use. Now when I laid them all out on a table, and again, I never realized how many prototypes and how many different things we had tried over the years. We had some copper ones, but they were way too big. That really was out of proportion. That was almost like for an RC size model. These were real close. And again, these get all hollowed out, of course. But I think the best thing, and as I look these over, and I'm not so sure I can't take. See, one of the ideas I thought I could take is, here's the original plug. I could take six of these and put them together. Just put a little bit different of an angle on them. But you know what? It's always good when you have a dilemma like this to think about it. And we had made some different stacks of that size and shape. These looked a little bit too big. See, here's what happens when you put something this size. It's just a little bit too big. Not a whole lot. And if I make these a lot bigger, it's going to look out of proportion. So again, the best thing here before I move forward with this, think about it overnight. Look at the new plugs that come out of those rubber molds, and in the morning I'll make a decision on this. A little time to think never hurts. Well, we wanted to get an early start because I want to see how those plugs for the molds came out. That's all drying up. Have my coffee and get cranking, closing in on having the woodwork done on our Spitfire. This is really an exciting time of year for me. And for the birds. Now this is really going to give us some choices, but we have some new parts too, because basically these are all the rejected parts that we've made over the years.
Now this is the critical thing, because I thought having these extra parts, in fact this one isn't really cured up yet. In fact none of these are cured up. Yeah, this one's cured. So what I'm gonna do, because these have not hardened up yet, and it could be that this molding epoxy, and this is West resin of course, what typically happens when you go to take a part like this out and it's not fully cured, sometimes it doesn't even pay. This one probably would come out. It's still soft though, because we've had it up by the heat. So a good trick is, and it's a good thing we saw this, a good trick is when you're going to take this out and it's still a little soft or uncured, we'll let this go till tomorrow or till the next session. Just let it cure some more. That's no problem. So in the meantime, what I'll do is I'll put these parts away. And by the way, when you go to take a part out and it's not really cured like this, a lot of times you tear the mold too, which is another bad problem. So, and this is the old green stuff we were using, that pearl paint stuff. Boy, have we learned a lot in the last 10 years or whatever. Anyway, so we can eliminate that right now for now, and I can start working on getting the mirror image part of that done while these parts are curing for another day or so. Now the first thing I did, I did this the other day when I cut the block, I put the reverse curve in the back. And to be honest, the reason I did it is I wanted to make sure I didn't make two lefts or two rights. But by looking at this, now I can just estimate real quickly how much material has to come off of here. And so having that first part carved will be a big help, somewhat of a big help anyway, as we take some of this material off and as our little molds are drying up. What I wanted to do is, my motive was, to have some brand new fresh parts, maybe figure out which one I wanted to use, because I got several choices there. And since I want to make extras, of course, probably be a good time to make a new mold if I decide. They've got about 6 different choices. Over the years we've made several different types, and it doesn't mean we won't even make another one, because this little by little is turning into one of the, again, it's not like this is unique. Every part of this model is like a focal point. I want it to be at least as good as I can make it, and as good obviously as within the realm of possibilities that we can do. Now, the thing is, I'm carving this as a mirror image, but I'm trying to carve it. The one scenario is I don't want to carve it too thin, because then once they're mounted on, and I've left this about 1/8 inch thick, so that I would have a little material, whichever one is the bigger of the two, I can just conveniently go back and even them both out. And since they have that little bit of curve where it curves into the nose, that's another issue. And what it boils down to in the overall thing is, this is not a 5-minute job. So whatever time this takes, and it really doesn't matter, it was good to see Mike the other day with his new Harley. Hey, he's having fun. Reliving our childhoods is what we all do best. Sports cars, Les with his 2 Corvettes, Wendy with his imaginary Ducati that somehow just never makes it. John Pothier has an older vet, collector vet. Everybody's got a Corvette except Wendy. I don't know if that's true or not. Now as I'm roughing this out, one of the things I want to constantly do is just go back and forth this way, because I don't want to make it thinner. Again, if it's a little thicker, it's okay, but I don't want to make it thinner. And if I could actually even press the two pieces together and just get some idea when I'm sneaking up on it. What happens as we get down to the nitty-gritty here, I just try to hold them together and see how close I'm getting. I can see in the back I'm still too fat, and I need more of a curve in the front to get them symmetrical. So first thing, let me thin out the back. And this is the point at which we start to take ice shaving. I call it ice shavings. You don't want to go getting a
And this is where if you have a brand new sharp blade, boy, it really pays. You can just shave off ice. Now I can feel how thick that got in the back. That's about right. And the trick is not to make one part a whole lot thinner than the other part, or then they both start getting too small. Sometimes you can do it just by feeling with your hand. In fact, this I have to take into account this one's hollow, but I can pretty much look down the top and see the thickness here. And we're getting close.
Now at this point, I'm ready to go over to the sanding bench, but I just want to see that I haven't gone too far. Oops. I'm a little bit thicker here. A little bit more of a bullnose on this one. And when I put the curve in there, that'll take care of the length. This one's about a 1/64 longer. And the main thing is where the exhausts are going to come out. I want that to be the same thickness on both parts, so one doesn't have long pipes sticking out and the other one's short. So this is ready to do the final sanding on.
Now, got the rough sanding in, but I don't have the part hollowed out, number one, and I don't have that little curve put in there yet. But I'm just looking for shape here. I've got the thickness at the bottom, almost like making little wheel pants, little sky hooks. I'm looking at the front to see if the bullnose is pretty similar. This one needs to be dressed off more. And I want to do this before we hollow it out. Now you could take a little piece of solder and bend it to that shape and see, but I can do this for this kind of a thing. I can do it by eye pretty well. But if you had problems, just take a piece of Stay-Brite saw to bend that curve and lay it out. Or in the worst of all worlds, you could make a template of this shape, the top view, but I don't think we need to go that far yet. I think we're just a couple sanding swipes away from having this. And we'll be ready to hollow it out and then put that curve in. And that, actually, maybe even in this session, we'll be ready to attach these. Hey, what I'm looking for is that the bull noses are, one isn't more tapered than the other. Oh, that's nice. That's good now. Okay, the next thing is going to be to hollow this out. Now, the big reason for hollowing this out is really not to save a couple of grams. The real reason for hollowing this out is it'll get a better footprint, because we won't have to deal with coming on the sides there. I just think I'll get a better footprint, a better glue joint to the fuselage if I don't have to deal with that wood in the middle. Which obviously we're going to find out. But it doesn't take many cuts of the knife to realize this piece is not anywhere near as good as the first piece, and they came out of the same block of wood. So that block of wood obviously is one of the things, and it's very common that a piece of balsa wood, one side of it can have a hard side and a soft side. And you know what? This is the hard side right here. Wow, it's hard to believe these came out of the same block of wood. The other one was absolutely like carving butter, and this one is like carving a piece of pine. But anyway, the trick here, and I'll keep monitoring it every step of the way, is to get that the thickness on both is roughly 1/8 of an inch. Roughly the same profile from the top view, I guess, is the most important. That's the view we're going to see the most. And then ultimately to get a nice seam around the whole perimeter. Now as I'm sanding this out, and I'm getting the last little bit of material out of here, the last thing is to get the fit up to the fuselage, and of course that's a little hit or miss thing we got to work on. But we do have And lucky for us, we do have this piece, which seemed to work well before. And this is the spare shell.
Go get vegetables,
baby. Keep us healthy. Keep us alive. At least till I finish this plane. Don't want to die in the middle of Spitfire construction. God, I don't want to die at all. What am I talking about? What the hell's this Spitfire got to do with it? I want to live. Brodax is... Yeah, we're ready. We already have our reservations. We're already ready. Ready for Brodax, the high point of our year. Now, I got to do a little test. See, I'm putting a little bit of a curve in here. Now, just to see how close we're getting this. Need a little more curve in the fuselage here. And that's what's nice about having that fake fuselage shell. Now, there's also another way to do this. And I wouldn't eliminate this. In fact, let's show this. This is the place where this is going to actually reside. We can do this. See, it'd be nice if I had a helper here. Well, right on the spot that it's going to go in. You would think it'd give us some kind of a nicer fit than usual. Even if it's not exact, we're close. Now, the next thing is to lay these out and position them in place. Now, I just want to get an idea of how far back with the spinner in place. A little further back than that. Actually, further back than that. Right about there. I want to mark that off with a piece of tape. Now, I spent quite a bit of time moving this back and forth and up and down to get exactly the look that I wanted. And it's tacked on, but I want to make sure it's tacked all the way. And I'll just run this bead. In case I want to take this off, I don't want to have it. This will just hold it in place. In case I decide I want to move this up or down. Now, this sets my clearance from this side. And the bottom of the exhaust go right up against the datum line that becomes the top of the fuselage. Now I can use the tape to line this one up too. I got the other one tacked in place. One little side benefit here is when I'm flipping a prop, I'll have a spot up in front of this to hold this. I don't want to hold it here, and it's very awkward to be holding it back here. So this will give me just enough room up in the front. I guess that was a little side benefit. I'm just going to tack this on and take the tape off and see if it looks like what I have in mind. If I ever needed you, now the early Merlin spits, they had a radius here, like this would all be aeropoxy lighted in, but these have a defined edge. There's an edge, it's almost like they're made, well I think they are made out of a separate piece of material. It isn't one piece because there's Zeus fittings all along here, so that would tell me that these somehow come off. And I guess right now we're as close as we're going to get this to having this in one piece up here. And now it's going to allow me to start figuring out exactly how I want to make the exhausts. And sometimes you just have to look at it from a lot of different angles. I think we got it. I think we're in way better shape than I thought we would be. That worked out. That worked out better than I thought it would. Now the next thing I wanted to do, I want to figure out which of the exhausts, boy, I like the top view of this too, which of the exhausts is going to be the appropriate choice. Now, of course, the most important thing, I want to make sure that I get the relative aspect ratio right. If the pipes are too long, it's going to look funny. If they're too short, it's just not going to look right. I need to get the pipes
And I have several of these blank prototypes that I can just do a rough fitting on. And there's so many choices the way these sweep back. And again, some of them do sweep down, the early ones sweep down. Some of them have two pipes into one. You really have a pretty free hand when it comes to doing this, but what I'm looking for is to make this as realistic as possible based on all of these books and pictures that I already have in my collection here. Now I'm just looking at this for, not for the pipe shape, but for the relative aspect ratio. And these, of course, are the early ones. They're not appropriate to a Griffin. Not that I know of. I've never seen a Griffin with these, what I'll call the fishtail pipes. But I wanted to see, and that looks like about the right length. So that's the length that we're going to be looking for when we look at all these prototype manifolds that we have. And we've got about 20 different ones here. It's ridiculous how many we have. Now this is a larger manifold that we have. But what happens is it starts to look too big. And the thickness of the pipes relative to the aspect ratio, the height of the body, this starts to look a little bit too large. So it's good that I know the length and I know what too big is. So now I need to know what's going to be right in between. And it's the same thing of figuring out what's too big, what's too small. And I at one time, the funny story, I had one time gone shopping with Karen and bought about 10 different kinds of macaroni to make a mold, because all the macaronis had a nice bend in them. And I got home and I said, what was I thinking? These are all the pipes were like, it was like I was making a manifold for a mouse cage or something. But that is true. Now I only use this as an example because this is one that we made up for some other purpose, but when the pipes get too big, see, there's something very wrong the minute the pipes get too big. When they're on the small side, nothing bad happens. But the rule is, at least my personal rule, is when the pipes, the diameter especially, this starts to look totally unrealistic. When they're too small, you can kind of buy into it. But when they're too big, and the reason I'm saying that is this is why I made so many of these years ago, is I had to learn the rules the hard way by just making a bunch of stuff that looked wrong. And just to make my point, when they're too small, and this one is a little on a small side, not way too small, but again, it very quickly is wrong, at least in my way of thinking, it's very quickly wrong when it's on the big side. On a small side, you can kind of get away with it. Now, this is the one I like so far, and it's got the right angle. It's got the right length, except the mold that we made this from is shot, and I'd have to remake the mold, which is still not a deal breaker. It's a simple reason is I can patch this up. In fact, I have two of these that I molded. So this is the one I'm kind of favoring right now, unless something better comes along in the next 10 minutes. Now, as I look at the last choice, and the last choice, again, I may do both of these and just see which one I like. I have a whole bunch of these individual parts that I made from a master mold. And what I thought about doing, now see these angle back at the wrong angle. These are really made to be Siamese pipes. But if I grind them and set them in this angle, and again I have to look at how that would look with a little less of an angle. And because they're really Siamese pipes, I really do have to make some change to that. If I use this, so I gotta, and this is the whole point before I do any of this, I've got a lot of choices. I just need to think about it. In fact, I have some of these individual pipes here that have the right angle, and maybe that's, now see that angle is way too, it's too straight out. It has to go further back. So I'm gonna look at what the possibilities are and what I'm going to do. I have the length I want, and I know the smaller diameter of the pipes I like better. And I can I have some aluminum tubing that I bought. I can even look at laying these up in aluminum tubing just to see what it looks like. Because again, I'm not in a rush. I don't need to have this finished by this afternoon. We're not going off to the circus or anything. I really want this to be, again, I keep saying it, canopy. This aircraft will have many focal points. and I want all of them to be eye catchers and to be as accurate as possible.
So what I decided to do, step one, is I had this piece, which is, it's clean enough to make a mold. These are parts that I made, and I really should clean the mold. Clean the part up, maybe put a coat of primer or something on it before I make another rubber mold. But I wanted to have a couple of choices here. Now the nice thing about this is not going to go on the model until it's all buffed out. So I don't have to make this big commitment this afternoon, but I'd like to get this moving along where I can look at it and evaluate it and think if I like it and whatever. And this one is going to need, there's some molding holes. I'm going to fill them with thick CA, try to sand it down, get it on a base plate, and get a couple of coats of primer on it, and then just think about this. And in the meantime, I could be looking at that aluminum tubing also, and I spend the rest of this day just thinking about how I want to do this.
Now, the easiest part of this is obviously getting it roughed in, but the hard part is going to be to get a nice finish on it. Each coat of the primer has to be sanded out, and when you make a mold like this, it's in here that's going to be a problem, because when you go to pull this part out, it's not going to be real solid here. So what I did, I put some extra CA in the manifolds themselves just to firm it up and try to cut, get a little more material in here, maybe just to make a little bit better part. Another thing that's nice about this, these are not round, they're oblong, which is a little more realistic on some of the spits. They have those, I guess that oblong would be the right word. But I don't really care tonight how much time it's going to take to detail sand this out, because once I pour a mold, and this part is, I'll be able to replicate it relatively easily, and I know this is very close to being the right shape. But once that's all sanded out, the next step will be a coat of primer. What I did, I put a coat of 5-minute epoxy. I heated it up a little bit and brushed it on just to make a nice finish. This is going to have to sit overnight to dry up, and then I'll probably sand it with 1200 and then prime it. Something like that anyway, but that's one choice. Now, I've thought about it long and hard about this alternative way of doing this, and I think I'm going to try making up a little prototype, because I really can't do much more with this and I have a little time left in this session. This would be a good time to try this and just see what it looks like. Now I wanted to cut, now let's see what size tube this is. I don't even know what size this is. 9/32 tubing. I wanted to try because I wanted to, see the problem with the tubing is getting nice neat cuts, which I'll work on that end of it. And I wanted to try making up a manifold, maybe a piece of plywood. In fact, I tried this in the past and it hadn't worked out the way I wanted to, but it looks like, in this case, here's the problem with doing this. The problem with doing it with tubing is how do you attach it in a solid way? And I want to have a little, see, I want to have these all to line up too. That's a problem. So what I decided to do is I'm going to cut these, and I've got to cut them all exactly the same. Well, there they go. Even if they're a little bit off, they have to be exactly the same. So I got to make up a little jig on the, I'm going to make a jig on a belt sander first to cut them all the same angle. And this will allow me an infinite amount of diameters until I get a diameter. It also allows me to make the length a little bit longer, and a little bit longer, maybe a little more prototypical. But now that we have the ogive, now I can see what this is going to look like in three dimensions. Now in the past, when I tried to make these, and what I tried to do on some of the ships, I don't remember which ones, but I'd try to glue each one individually. What happens is you have such a tiny footprint of glue, and from vibration and things, these were really unreliable. In fact, on the I-beam Spitfire, there's one missing right now. So I wanted to make some kind of a base plate, some kind of a manifold, that I could somehow attach these, that they'd really be solid, and maybe glue them to the base plate with epoxy or JB Weld or something that would be dead reliable. Hey, that's what I'm afraid would be the problem. And these would be real nice. And the thing that's real nice is having this ability to make these infinitely bigger and smaller. Anyway, let me show you how I was cutting these up before. Now, just to show you, once I turn this on, I have this as my angle, and I just want to just take enough off. And the trick with making this is to go very slow so you don't tear it all up and make an uneven edge. Then I go over to the bench, measure the length I want, and I'm going to have to do that pretty carefully and get a brand new blade and just score it and pop it off. See, the tube starts. If I hold this edge and hold this angle, the trick is not to try to do it too fast. This gives me hopefully an accurate angle that I can make 12 exactly the same. Now you can see how long that is, so what it's going to give me, I'm going to be able to make these even a little bit longer than I want to have them. When I was molding these, it's very difficult to mold these long and get all these edges the same. But with the tube, it'll be relatively easy. That edge has to be dressed off, and it's easier to dress it off right now than my favorite tool. And the rougher I can make this, the better it'll probably. In fact, I better roughen this up anyway. Now the trick is using this and these two pieces of tape for the guide, put it on the hard side. And I've got to roll this whole piece of tubing, just like a tubing cutter. And it eventually pops. So now I have the parts the length, and all I have to do is dress this off. Now what I'm going to do, just to see if I'm going to like this, I'm going to make 6 of these up this length and just make a fake manifold or a test manifold. Now what I tried to do, I took the edge that's going to go against the wood and roughened it up with a Dremel tool. But what I wanted to do, and I realize we're not going to get a whole lot more done because we're getting up near the end of this video, but I wanted to just maybe finish up this part. I just took a piece of 1/64 plywood to make this what's going to ultimately be a mounting plate. And I figured what I'd do is I'd mount these up with JB Weld, since I know that's a good structural resin. But I need to hold them in place. And I can't hold them in place while the JB Weld is drying, or they're all going to start tipping over and they won't be even and whatever. So what I thought would be a good alternative here, and I'm not sure it is until I try this, is to try to do these one at a time. First get them lined up. And let's just see if even if one drop will hold this in place. You really don't need more than one drop. It's just going to hold it while the JB Weld is drying. And what I thought I could do is heat the JB Weld and drip some down. I roughened up the inside of the pipe and the outside so that the JB Weld, I could get in there with a Q-tip, possibly, and do it that way. So let's see if it's my lucky day here. Now, the choices are, these don't want to touch each other or they don't look realistic. They have to be spaced. So I have to come up with a way of spacing them equally. Let's see how I can do that. Maybe a piece of sandpaper? Maybe a piece of Teflon. Let's see what we got there. I think sandpaper would be better. So if I just have a double piece of 220 sandpaper, all right, maybe that'll work. We're going to find out.
probably the hard way too. Now I can see that this is really not real solid yet. Use the spacing of the double sandpaper. Let's see, how can we do this a different way? Got to think this through. Got to have a better way. There's got to be a better way of doing this. Because if these are not spaced equally, or if they're spaced all crooked and one's up and down, I'm not going to be happy with it. Well, unfortunately, what it looks like is the best way is just eyeball these pieces. Now, this prototype I wasn't happy with. And the reason is, there's too much of a space between the pipes to be scale, and that what happens is the space adds up and it's getting too long. So pretty much what I'm going to do is just pull these off, glue them together so they're almost touching. But I need to make up a little jig so that, see, what I don't want to have happen is from the end that one of them doesn't line up or something. So I need to make the equivalent of a little jig. And this looks like it's going to work pretty well, by the way. It'll give us one other option for when we go to actually make the real parts. Now, I tried to figure something out. Here's what I tried to figure out. Not sure if this is going to work. This is the spacing of the pipes. So I need a little jig. What I want to do is make a little jig. Actually, I could make... It's just going to look like a sawtooth when I'm done. And what I found worked well, just to tack these together. Well, you know, sometimes the smallest little thing just makes you crazy. Because now I have to get all of these at 90 degrees. But this will certainly be better than the way it was. Let me just see the spacing. This could be a little bit longer. Spacing is correct. Spacing is long. Oh man, sometimes, but we won't give up. And believe me, if they're off even a 64th of an inch, the tiniest little amount, well, you know, I can see it anyway. Now, when we're all done, I'll sand this, just one drop of thick C8 to hold this temporarily. And this also allows me to get them flat, which is a gigantic advantage right now. And then I'm working on a piece of Teflon so the glue doesn't stick, but now that I have three of them, I'm going to put a drop of glue on the other side just to hold them together. This is just temporary until I can get this. This actually solves a lot of problems, but I'm not sure I'm going to like the look. That's why I'm approaching this from several different angles. It's like drafting three quarterbacks in the same draft, so you know the one you want. In the end, we'll have it. And I don't know why, to be honest, I don't know why. This is the part of modeling that I get frustrated. And at the end of the day, I get this good feeling that I've figured something out. You see, that's not straight when I do that. See, it's getting these bologna slices right. Now, I can picture what would work. And this, because I don't have a lot of this tubing either. I ought to go buy some more tubing. It's the glue 8-inch lengths of this tubing together and then somehow zona saw it off and get this edge. It would be a lot easier than doing it this way. I got the wrong edge on this. Now I can see it's off already. Boy, it doesn't have to be off much. I still can't get it this way. There we go. This will, in effect, make the... Now, look at this. Now it's crooked. It'll make the manifold shorter, which is going to be more in keeping with what we want. And by tacking it like this, I can rotate these so a certain amount anyway. Now you would think this wouldn't be that big of a problem. Wrong. Let me just tack this now and see how much off it is. See, because I'm looking down this. I'm trying to hold it straight at the same time. It would definitely be easier to go buy about 10 pieces of this tubing, glue them all together. Or even that, Brian has that aluminum solder. I'm wondering if that wouldn't even work. But I don't mind doing up these little prototype things because I know in the end, this didn't work out. That's closer to it. I can just see that that's wrong. And if this is too close together, then I got to punt the football and go.
I'll bet you're laughing. I know you're laughing.
Now I can see. I'm trying to look at it from several different angles. Those are just tacked together. There's nothing really holding them on. But I can see I've got, they're all in good alignment this way. And I don't have any crooked. But I still think it's worth making a little jig with a little sawtooth edge. Lining these up, and maybe if I could buy some more of this tubing today, I don't think the hobby store is open. Make these longer and just cut them. Get these all attached together temporarily. But even this way worked. And it, you know, even though this is not the final be-all end-all, this is one of the ways I want to have as my option when it comes time to putting these on. Now the next thing I need to do on this is, and I hope this doesn't break now, because we're working with delicate little stuff. Get this perfectly flat and glue this up to a piece of 1/64 plywood. And just want the minimum amount of thick CA on there holding that together. Actually, I think this is going to work pretty good. This might be the way of choice, in fact. Now, one advantage of this is don't have to paint it so it'll look like real aluminum or steel or whatever. This can be wire brushed or polished or whatever. But believe me, these have to be on solid. That's the one thing I know for sure. These cannot be on some Mickey Mouse way. Now, our little prototype, and I want to make one up. I'll just put this aside to dry tonight with JB Weld. This will be one good way to do it. I know the JB Weld will be as strong as possible, but the trick is I have to get, it shouldn't really be a trick, I have to get inside the pipes. And that's why I had a little bit of trying to think of how I wanted to do this. And I don't know if this is going to be the way, a good way. And I hope this doesn't break, of course. But we'll find out. So, you know, what I'll do is I'll get some inside each one of the pipes. And then I'll heat this with a hairdryer and let it make a radius inside the pipe. Actually, if this works out, this will be kind of nice. In effect, you can make these a lot thinner and more realistic than the cast ones. But boy, talk about a part that's difficult to make. A little tiny part, you don't think it matters. Now, John Cafaro had these nice manifolds made, but they weren't made to a Spitfire. They were made to the early Mustangs. I got plenty in there, so that should work well. Okay, now the trick is, ha 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 ha. Which side is this? Will be okay. Now this will all get trimmed off. Now another thing, if we decided to use these manifolds, I could cut into the fuselage side down to the plywood so these could be three-dimensional. Because these are going to be so thin that I'd only have to cut. Well, I'm getting a horse ahead of the cart here. But I do like the way this is looking so far. Now I wanted to,
let's get rid of this for now,
get this on something flat. And just drop this in here. And there is really a lot of frustration when you have something like this and halfway through a fly-in season one of the pipes comes off. That's
takes all the fun out of being a Spitfire pilot.
Especially, you know, and when it always happens, it's at an embarrassing time. All your friends are looking at the model. Hey, one of your pipes is missing. Hey, with my luck, somebody like Bill Rutherford would find it. Okay. He'd be able to get even with me for all these scams we're playing on him. Anyway, now... now that we have this, I want to get this up onto the pipes just enough. And the heat should melt some of the JB weld that's down inside and make like a, well, we could always put a little more down in there. Because being able to mount this manifold into the plane, it would allow me to recess it. Actually, it would look pretty cool, 3D. Let me get the heat. Well, we'll still have plenty of time to think about this because we don't need to have this today. It's always nice to be working on a part you don't need today. Now, when I go to set this, I'll have to tape this to the table. Okay. Let me get something to just hold this down while this is drying. Now, when we come back to this tomorrow, we'll see what we can do about cleaning up that JB weld. I've got it taped to the table, so hopefully it dries nice and flat. It'll be best if we let it sit overnight. We're at the end of this session, and tomorrow we can go back and see which one of these things we're going to want to make a second copy of, or if we're going to want to modify this, or how it's going to look, and most of all, how it's going to fit into that fuselage. And we'll see how it is tomorrow. Oh my God, another rainy day. Well, at least it isn't a snowy day. We are just getting bombed with rain and snow, but rain is definitely better than snow. Now in today's mail, I got a nice disc from Joe Adamusco with some pictures of, well, it's a photo slideshow of him detailing his cockpit out. And I wanted to include it on this because we're really at the end of doing cockpit type of work. And this would be the appropriate DVD to include it in, but just look close at some of the little details Joe has included in on this. It's really, I think, pretty spectacular.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that slideshow from Joe Adamusco of how his cockpit's coming along. And I want to thank Joe and, of course, all the people that share photos, share information, share everything. Whether you do it over the internet or through a magazine or whatever, it doesn't really matter. Or if you just choose to do it through a personal thing like these videos, I think we all benefit by the sharing. I'm very convinced that in the end, that's one of the things that bonds us as a brotherhood of cockpit detailers. Anyway, we're going to get back to the shop. That was a nice presentation. Thank you, Joe.
Now, among the people that have really shared the world of Spitfires, our friend Rich Walbridge, of course, and I got a little sneak peek at Elliot Scott is going to be videotaping his new shop that he's got extensive amounts of time and energy into, and I'm hoping Les Demet is having a shop built. It's designed by a professional architect, and he's going to be hopefully keeping us in a loop on how his shop is coming out. And of course, the biggest thing, we're going to get to see Rich Oliver's new shop when we go to Texas later this year.
And it would be unfair to mention somebody who I think has one of the nicest shops around. Of course, our good friend John Brodeck, and we're going to be seeing him in a very short amount of time, in a few months. John, we already got reservations. Get that barbecue cooking up there, baby. John and Buzz Brodeck, thank you very much.
Now, this may sound a little funny, but I took this morning, ground it all down, cleaned up the back, polished it with a little bit of that mother's aluminum polish. Seemed to polish up pretty nice. Now, one of the things I'm going to need to do is, next time I use JB Weld, which is going to be in about an hour, I'm going to heat the JB Weld, put it on the end of a Q-tip, and run it down into each pipe so that internally I build a fillet in each pipe. Again, these are nice and light, so it's not a problem, but I don't want to have that in the middle of the fly-in season or in the middle of our trip to Texas or at Brodeck's or something. I have an 11-cylinder, 11-exhaust pipe ship. So, and because I've already built, well, we've already made every kind of manifold. We've probably got enough video on making manifolds to choke a horse. But these came out pretty nice. And I may be even considering using these, even though I just have them as a prototype. I think they have a lot of appeal to me. And the fact that the pipes are so close together gives us a realistic length. One of the things I never liked about some of the ones I made were the pipes always seemed to be too far apart to be scale. Now, what really helped us out here, too, was all the photos Gerald Champ had sent us from the Spitfire Museum, just to give us a look at what this is going to look like when it's installed. And one of the things I'm considering, once I get the second one of these made, and I'll make the second one off camera, is recessing this, getting an exact pattern of the back of this, and recessing it into the fuselage so it's a little more realistic. Not glued to the outside, recessing it in, maybe take a 16th of a balsa wood away or whatever. And what makes this nice too, I think, is the fact this, the JB Weld, is a realistic color. It's not clear, it's not a color that's going to stand out in a crowd. So whatever color we paint the model, this is going to just going to help it stand out. But picture when that valve cover covers this little piece of it, you're not even going to see the JB Weld, but it'll be even better if we recess this in. And I'm going to think about doing that in the next session. But the next thing I need to do, and I want to do it off camera, because we're at the end of this video, and I don't want to run off and be in the middle of a video when we do the next part of the detail. And we only have a few more days of woodworking and a few more days of detail, and then we'll be ready for that, bringing everything up into its final coat of silver. And then the biggest challenge of all, what paint scheme we're going to use. So, hope you've enjoyed the video. And I hope we'll see you on the next tape.